Shall we play a game?
You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009. Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Be sure to connect with us on social media and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss our next broadcast. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
Ladies and gentlemen, now suddenly I can't hear myself.
That's okay. We don't have to hear you at all.
No, but I can't hear myself at all. Why is that?
Well, then don't talk, and I'll just talk the entire time.
No, but what's going on there? I just had this thing working.
It's a sign that they just want to hear me.
It could be. All right, welcome everybody. We are live from Bunker 2.5. And there it is. Are these, you know, the headphone amp might be cutting out. All right, we are here. It is, what is today? Wednesday.
It's Wednesday. Happy hump day. Happy don't listen to the boss day.
Oh, yeah, right. Whatever. Anyway. All right. So, hi, everybody. We are loaded today. I'm not sure exactly where we're going to start.
I'm going to start.
You're going to start?
But you're going to sit there, do your little...
You do your thing while I figure out this
headphone
thing.
So, I figured it's been a minute since I've had my rants. So, I'm going to take a minute to rant. As you know, I constantly am working to put together our convention list, which added
yes.
another one last night. Thank you. And I have many thoughts and comments on conventions. Now, not all of them are good. Not all of them are bad. So I am going to say I love what I do. And second of all, I'm going to state that anybody who might be involved with doing conventions, there are some little things that you might want to consider, you know, and usually it's, when I make these comments, it's regarding the websites, so I don't have to sit there and pretend I'm booking a room to find out when the actual convention is. But I'm going to move on from the website to emails, because a lot of times the emails that we get do not list when the conventions are, where the conventions are. And the where's not such a big thing. It's more of when the conventions are. And they have no links. Or if the links that are provided in the email, they're for, by the way, we're having a convention. Mm-hmm. And if you're interested in being a vendor, click here. And the click here goes to a apply here, register here, or hey, we're having a convention, get your tickets, click here. And it goes to a third party site that has the tickets available, but that third party site does not have a link to the website for the convention, so you can't look at all the information on the convention itself. It just gives you the option to purchase tickets. Yes, pretty much. Now, I know that if you scroll all the way down, then there's usually the little icons, Facebook, Instagram, Twixer. But that's usually for, I don't know, MailChimp.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of deceiving because you'll click on it. You're like, hey, I'm going to the website for MailChimp. So I'm just pointing out that to make it easier for those who are subscribed to the newsletter, which I absolutely love. Thank you for all the conventions out there that have a newsletter. Be sure that the convention date is in there somewhere. You know, if it's in the banner or just, hi guys, we're having a convention on this date.
You know, a while back, I did a video. I did an entire session. I did an entire hour on this show about what to do from a marketing standpoint, you know, for authors and creators to sit there and go, you know, here's the things what you need to remember to do when you're promoting your work. You know, a headshot, bio, this, that. Maybe we should do a workshop on marketing Comic-Cons. Here are the things that you need to think about when you're promoting your event, whether it's a Comic-Con or if it's a little book club thing, or, you know, something at the library, or, you know, the university put something together. There needs to be something.
Well, and I've had a few shows, I think I do at least one a year, where I have talked about the websites. And this is the first time I've actually said something about the emails. Because I get a lot of emails because every time I go to a site for a convention, yeah. Even if it's one that I've been there for, you know, I've seen it and it's been on our list for a while, I always make sure that I go to the newsletter and sign up, even if I get the little sign or the little notification, oh, you're already signed up. Oh, good. I don't have to think about this.
Yeah.
Because like us, we have a newsletter. You can sign up for our newsletter. We're pretty good about getting a couple out every year. And they're the same way.
I am going to be better about that. But by the way, how is our sound? Because I know we were having trouble with it yesterday. I figured out, apparently, in my Microsoft settings, my Windows settings for the computer, the microphone output had been dialed down quite a bit. And I don't know how that happened. So,
hey, just, how'd that happen?
Yeah. But anyway, I think it's important to remember that a lot of these people, and you and I have talked about this mm-hmm. before, there are a lot of people out there who are organizing and running these things, who are, they're all volunteers, they're all civilians, I guess you could apply that term to it, and they don't have they don't have training, official formal training in marketing and promotion and advertising and mass communications and media and that kind of thing. You get, you know, if you have an event where you have somebody who's got that training, who's working on your marketing team, that's a bonus almost, because, you know, there are a lot of people out there that don't know boo about any of this. You know, they don't know about headshots. They don't know about, you know, web links and...
Well, I'm not asking for a web link on everything, but just anything
in general, just from a marketing standpoint, you got to have a strategy, you got to have a schedule, you got to have a plan. Okay, well, we do this, and then this happens, and this happens, and then we'll announce this, and we'll tease this here. And
I just want dates.
I know.
I mean, don't get me wrong. You're perfect, Mr. Boss.
No,
but I still want dates.
But that should be the first thing that gets emphasized in the workshop. It's like, look, in every piece of communication that goes out about your event, a guest announcement, a newsletter, a change of venue, price changes are going to, you know, here, the early bird price deadline, all of any kind of communication at all that you have about
Wait,
your event.
Are you old enough to get early bird pricing?
Early bird is not retirement. Thank you.
But don't they have an early bird dinner?
No.
I'm not saying retire. I'm just saying, are you? Hey. I'm just saying.
Just
the
remember,
price.
You push my buttons, I'll push this button over here. No, but every single piece of communication that goes out, whether it's a social media post, it's a graphic, it's any kind of announcement, any kind of a date change, a venue, anything, somewhere on there, noticeably must be dates and location. It doesn't necessarily have to be the actual physical space, but April 23rd, Houston, Texas, that needs to be in everything. You make a graphic on, you post something on Instagram, it should be in the graphic and in the text. You do something over on Facebook, in the picture and on the text describing the thing, everything. Date, location, April 23rd, Houston, Texas, March 27th, Calcutta. I mean, it was something. Everything has to be so that, and the website, So date, location, website, because that way you provide just the core amount of information so that people can sit there and go, okay, this is at the end of April. It's in Houston. How do I find out more? I'm going to be in Houston in April. Let's find out. Here's the website. Go click on it. Every piece of communication that goes out, press release, anything that goes to the news media, those three things got to be on everything that you send out.
And it doesn't even have to be a hyperlink. I mean, I understand there are people who are volunteers and they don't know exactly how to do certain
things. Well, in a graphic, you can't make a hyperlink in a graphic unless it's online.
But even if you sit there and you put in www.fanexpohq.com, that is enough to copy and paste over.
Right.
Even
and
if
with
it,
Instagram,
like I said,
I mean,
even
you
if
can't
it's
put,
not.
You can't put live hyperlinks in Instagram anyway. So you're just typing it in. But those three things have got to be on everything that you send out if you're running any kind of promotional campaign for an event of any kind. That's what I'm saying.
Okay, all that right. Was my rant.
Okay, let me get your take on this suggestion that we had yesterday.
Oh, by the way, can I have one more moment?
One more moment?
Yeah. I just want to sit there and say, I want to give a shout out to someone who has been doing some stuff with us over on the Fan Activity Gazette, sent me an email to let me know that when they were looking at my list that goes on or into the Gazette for the next month and the conventions, noticed that something was going to be near them. So they went to go look it up and found out that the location and town was going to be different. So they sent me an email to let me know so that I could update that. And so I just want to say thank you, you know, and I really appreciate when I get those type of emails from You know, whether it's someone reading the stuff or looking at our website or listening to the show, it helps me. We've got like we've got over 2,000. We're
2,780.
Yeah, we're getting up there to that 3,000 mark, and I hope to hit it before the end of the year. But
see, we have more conventions on this list than we do YouTube subscribers. And that number, that should not be the case.
Well, and I keep telling Mr. Boss we should have a race on this. I think I would win. But anyway,
well, as quickly as we keep losing subscribers on YouTube, it might be a race to the bottom.
That's true. But anyway, I do appreciate it when I have people reach out to give me tips and information, because that is a lot. And I know that when it's coming back from the pandemic, not all of our conventions were able to come back, because they look on what happens this year to help pay for next year. And especially these smaller ones, it's not easy. And there's a lot of work that goes into, you know, putting these conventions together. You know, as much work as they put in for these ones that'll draw in 30,000 people over a day, it's the same thing for those who pull in 30 people for the afternoon. And so it's a lot of work for everybody. And like I said, I do appreciate it when others step in and help out so that I can keep that list, one, growing, and two, being as current as possible.
Yeah.
So thank you, Bob. Much appreciated.
Speaking of being current, because, you know, we're all about cutting edge news coverage here, right?
We are.
Well, you know, who knows? So I had a suggestion yesterday, because we were talking about the fact that we, you know, do we have subscribers? Do we not have subscribers? We keep losing them. We're not gaining them. Everybody else, you know, hey, a million subscribers, 300,000 subscribers, 25,000 subscribers. Here we are, 2,514. We've lost four.
Excuse me for a moment. Vader's out.
What?
Vader's out.
All right. I will. So
do you want Vader? Do you want to deal with Vader? Do you want me to do it?
Huh? Go take care of it. Go take care of it. I'll vamp. Go before he gets lost.
Bye-bye.
Go. All right. Vader is loose in the neighborhood. Not Darth Vader. All right. So I will put a pin in this until Mrs. Boss gets back. In the meantime, let's go over here and do some Gamergate stuff. Let's start with Gamergate, because I don't think Minnie's got any interest in Gamergate. Let me see where I can find it here, because I've got a lot of tabs open. Okay, so the Gamergate thing continues to blow up. That parkplace.com coming under fire. Let me show you just on their website the different articles that they've got. I'll just show you headlines. Forspoken consultant Black Girl Gamers threatens legal action against That Park Place, claims they are committed to diversity and inclusion, including our non-discriminatory hiring practices. Now, Black Girl Gamers apparently has put up some different things with regard to job opportunities and a discussion board, but there are criteria for becoming members and having access to this stuff, and one of those things is that you can't be white, apparently. And That Park Place reported on this seemingly discriminatory practice, and Black Girl Gamers is now threatening legal action. Well, if I sit there and say seemingly, that makes it an editorial. You're not reporting as fact. You're saying, hey, this is a question that we have about what's going on. So what you could do is you could answer the question instead of hiding behind threats of lawfare. I mean, that could be a thing. So here's the article. This is John Trent writing. Video game consultancy organization Black Girl Gamers threatened to take legal action against That Park Place following a report that it appears the company discriminates in their hiring practices. In an article titled Forespoken Consultant Black Girl Gamers Appears to Discriminate in Their Hiring Practices While Claiming They Are Being Harassed. And that headline is way too long, John. That headline is three times too long. You cut that down by a third, John. It was posited that it appeared that the organization was discriminating in their hiring practices based off a post the organization made on Twixer that read, quote, looking for black women content creators that make Dungeons & Dragons content for some potential brand work, hit us up. The post was also shared in an article titled Children's BBC host Jules Hardy calls for final purge of gamers after boycott list created for consultants black girls gamers. Also, this headline is too long. Do I need to do a workshop on how to write headlines? Guys, come on. So here's the post. What?
Which headline?
All of that Park Place, thatparkplace.com, their headlines are just too bloody long. Following the publication,
about the one where they announced the wrong thing. Which one was it that you showed me?
I don't remember. I don't know what I showed you. All right, continuing here. Following the publication of these two articles, Black Girls Gamers took to X, Twixer, to threaten legal action against That Park Place. The organization wrote, quote, we're addressing the recent allegations published on thatparkplace.com about discriminatory hiring practices within Black Girl Gamers. The very name Black Girl Gamers kind of leads you toward thinking that maybe they're going to be discriminating, but, you know, that's just me. These claims are false and were made without prior fact-checking or verification from us or our representatives. Black Girl Gamers operates as a contracting organization that collaborates with both freelancers and content creators from all backgrounds to work on various projects and initiatives to amplify underrepresented voices in gaming and make the community more inclusive, which means that they're going to help you make a game that won't sell. Next, they wrote, contrary to the allegations of the article, Black Girl Gamers has contracted freelancers of all races, genders, sexual orientations, religions, and ethnic backgrounds. We have also included representation of all genders and backgrounds in our content, at our events, and in our marketing, consultation, and research projects, some of which are not publicly disclosed due to NDAs. Now, there's nothing in there that says anything about hiring based on skill.
Wait, you do that?
Right? Shouldn't you? So this is blowing up. In the meantime, as a result of this, you have the BBC getting involved. Not the BBC, but a presenter at BBC, Jules Hardy. Jules Hardy reposted a Black Girl Gamers tweet. And then she says this, quote, can we agree that for round two of this, it can be the final purge of these kinds of gamers? It's 2024. I've been arguing about this for decades. Can we have a last full detox of these dudes so we can get back to the positive gaming community we have been creating? All right. One, the gaming community has not been around for decades. Video games have been around, yes, for a very long time, and women have been playing video games for a very long time.
How many decades are we talking about?
See, that's the thing.
I'm just asking because, you know, back, I mean, two decades would take us into 2004, and even before that, I was part of a gaming community for Ashran's Call.
Yeah, but I mean,
and that's older than a couple decades. So I'm just going to take a little bit of whatever for what you just said.
But this wording that she's got here now she's a BBC on the air personality. This is not just some random person on the internet. This is a media figure. Over in the BBC. Are we dismissing Atari? No, we're not dismissing Atari. But what I'm concentrating on is the online aspect of this. Because prior to that, you play an Atari, you're playing Asteroids on your 2600. You're not communicating with anybody else. You're playing on your console at home. There was no online component on this until, you know, the internet, and then suddenly there were online video games.
And board was where we were at for AC.
Yeah.
And then, that was just AC. That doesn't even include all the other ones. But since AC is kind of the godfather or grandfather for all those MMORPGs, whatever, I'm that's the only reason I'm taking
a very long time. We were all dying of dysentery by ourselves. I mean, we were.
Because
you weren't at the, you weren't. This is a generational thing. But anyway, this thing about final purge, this word here that she uses, this is something where it's like, okay, what exactly do you mean by that, Jules? Because you're a person who gets on the camera and talks for a living, and this is what you do. So word selection, probably you understand a little bit about that. What exactly do you mean by that? Now, Melanie Mack asked her about it. And she says, I want to purge the hate and vitriol from gamers who refuse to allow gaming to evolve and adapt as we humans are doing. I have no problem with opposing viewpoints, but hate, violence, and aggressive behavior isn't okay in any realm you live within. Fine, but this kind of stuff, this kind of hate and vitriol and all of this mess, this wasn't as much of a thing, I don't think, as people want to make it out to be until the progressives got involved. You get people who, I see something that's very popular, and I want it to reflect me, so I'm going to tell you how to change it so that I can have my representation, and you have all of these different, all these different little silversmith babies coming through and doing these consultancies for video games and saying, oh, that's sexist. Oh, that's racist. Is her booty a little bit too big? Oh, she's too curvy. You can't do that. Oh, you can't make her look pretty. And then we get to put a chicken in and make her lame and gay. That's where we are now. And so now you have backlash against all of these companies that are using these Sarkeesian-type consulting firms that are saying, put a chick in it, make it lame and gay. I know there were groups and there were parties and this. I'm not dismissing all of that. I'm talking about the online community that exists now. That just to clarify.
It's always been there for, like, the late 90s at least, on.
Yes, I know. I remember
back when we were, you know, like I said, back on the VIN boards with Ashran's Call. You had your different servers. They had their own boards. And I remember the controversy when you found out someone who had a female name, and all the guys, of course, because girls gaming, oh my god, and they would sit there, and when it came out that girl name was a guy, and just how,
yeah,
I mean the stuff that you see these days, yeah, that happened, that's always gonna happen, that was always happening beforehand.
Well,
not
like
to the
Baser
same
extent,
not to the same extent,
yeah,
that we see these days. But, you know, back when it was still more of a fresh idea, and then IGN stepped in and ruined all the fun. But
any of the games media, any of the entertainment media, the alternative media, the niche media does that. But Mazers is right. Women have been playing video games since the original Pong home consoles, right alongside men. All this is being touted as a dishonest narrative. And I agree with that. I think that's right.
But if it didn't happen after they were born,
yeah,
it never did. And these people writing, they don't know what a, yeah, you know,
what we were doing.
Yeah,
then.
Gojira says, I find this woman's repeated use of purge hilarious. Bet going back a couple of weeks she was clutching pearls about a bloodbath. Probably. All right, Cam, we'll get to it. See, that's the thing here. It's this, we need to purge this behavior. We need you to comply with the new standard. We're trying to modify behavior and get you and we're 1984-ing this into you must do how we say. You must believe how we believe. You must act the way we tell you to act. And this kind of behavior should not be allowed anymore. And I will admit that I was not an online gamer. I never have been. I haven't participated in team games or groups or anything like that. So I don't know how prevalent this stuff was prior to the Me Too movement getting weaponized and now everything's sexist. But I find it very difficult to believe that it was or is as much of a problem as these people want to make it out to be. This reminds me of the Marxist grift from people like Jesse Jackson or the Reverend Al Sharpton. This is bait to create a problem, to create a controversy in order to come in and sweep in on your white horse and be the hero and say, I can fix this problem. Even though nobody was ever aware that there was a problem to begin with.
Oh, I mean, and even before the Me Too movement and everything like that, I remember back when I got into World of Warcraft because someone was mentioning that Mrs. Death played World of Warcraft.
Yeah.
And it was controversial the fact that you had it was in AC when I went back to playing AC. That you had guys running around in dresses. And bunny slippers.
Okay.
And I mean, because there was a period of time where we stopped playing AC and then we went back to AC before we got into World of Warcraft. I apologize. And because with AC, you could get away with a guy wearing girl clothes and vice versa, where with, you know, not so much with World of Warcraft. Mm-hmm. But you would sit there and you would have people who are upset that the guys were running around with dresses on, or the fact that you had someone who would wear their mask for, I can't even remember what it was, and nothing else except bunny slippers. And, you know, so you had a half-naked toon with, you know, a mask and bunny slippers running around. And people took offense to that and would sit there in chat, say, you know, in chat, in-game, where everybody in town could sit there and see and make comment over, dude.
Yeah.
No.
Well, and nowadays that kind of thing is celebrated. And it goes back to something even broader because we keep talking about culture war stuff. It has been pointed out that all of the stuff that we're seeing now with regard to the transgender movement and women wearing dresses and pretending that they're women and all of this LGBT stuff and the Marxism socialism. The last time this became a very prominent thing was the Weimar Republic, the Weimar district in Germany pre-World War II. This is leading up to something. And if Jules Hardy wants to call for a purge, what are you talking about? By the way, I don't think it's any coinkydink that Jules Hardy recently, like in the last, it's not recent. This is May of 2022 when she did this. She said, been doing some thinking these past few months. Now, this is 2022, so this is pandemic lockdown year, right? So we're all having existential crisis. So I've been doing some thinking these past few months and taking some time to reflect on things, and I have some personal news I'm happy to share with you all. I'm non-binary. Nobody cares. How does that affect your job performance as a presenter on the BBC? It doesn't. It doesn't. I don't know. Bianca showing up over on Odyssey. Good to see you over there. Yeah, I'm bored and I need attention. It is tired and stupid. I mean, yeah, Seamus and Lara Croft and Alex Vance, Gears and Crackdown don't have white leads. They're not breaking ground. See, this is the thing we talked about with regard to Star Trek Discovery. Michael Burnham is not the first black lead in Star Trek. She's not the first black character in Star Trek. She's not the first black woman in Star Trek. She's not the first whatever in Star Trek. I mean, all these people sit there and hail her as the conquering hero because she's the first. And she's not. None of these people understand that things happened before they were born. Stuff happened more than 20 years ago, more than 30 years ago, more than 40 years ago, more than 80 years ago. History happened. And you need to crack open a book and look and see and, oh, and sometimes history repeats itself. What?
Do they teach reading in school?
Reading comprehension? Probably not.
Okay.
As we have demonstrated here on more than one occasion. Speaking of Michael Burnham.
It was George. George.
Why are you doing a Nazi salute there?
George Herbert.
George Herbert? Yes. God. So Variety puts out this article about Dune. And I've got the article. I don't have the tweet pulled up. But more than likely, they've deleted it by now because somebody called them out on it. But they were talking about George Herbert's Dune. Like, did Frank's brother write a Dune? Did Frank have a brother? Do you not have editors? Do you not have people that fact check this stuff? That look at this stuff? Even spell check? I mean, what is the world coming to? And yes, I've seen all the conspiracy theories about what happened in Baltimore. And who knows? Yes, the movie Cabaret. Perfect example. That's exactly the kind of thing I'm talking about. Then it was cross-dressers. Now it's transgender. We've just escalated. That's all.
Okay, guys. Let's start taking bets. What's the next one?
Well, I mean, if you go back and you track the history of that, you could probably predict it.
That is true.
Yeah. I mean, there were, tons of powerful female characters in Trek, including an admiral or two in Next Generation, and we've got Voyager. Yeah, no, I know.
They're not all Davos girls.
So, before I get to Star Trek, let me circle back to the idea that we were going to discuss before we got interrupted by Vader.
Actually, it was Gus.
Gus?
Well, no, Gus was over across the street, but because he's never seen Gus, he wasn't sure.
Oh,
and
I
so
see.
The neighbor
so
was out.
Nobody got loose. It was just Gus was out.
Gus was out. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So right. We were good. We're good.
Okay. So the idea was posited yesterday.
And at least it wasn't your tweet that
with
you
regard
me.
With regard my tweet that showed. What are you talking about?
We're doing it wrong. Where you need to
put
another
yeah,
camera.
No, yeah, mm-hmm. No. I could do that.
No.
We could put a camera over there behind you.
No. Does that say anything, guys?
Okay. So the idea was put forth yesterday that we should have a daily Sydney Sweeney update in order to goose our numbers and build our subscribers and, you know, grow our audience by every day having a Sydney Sweeney story and putting Sydney Sweeney in the thumbnail for the video. So, Mrs. Boss, what do you think about that? Should we do a daily Sydney Sweeney update?
Well, I mean, if you want to sit there and have people say that we're, you know, trying to, I don't know the word I'm looking for, but I mean, there is going to be people out there who will take the clickbait, and there'll be people out there who sit there and say we're trying to, you know, use sex to sell.
Yeah. I mean, Green Girl says thumbnail is essential.
It has to be. I mean, we'll have to sit there and really work every day to get a different thumbnail because we don't want them to get bored of the same thumbnail.
Well, see, because, you know, it's funny because we have the timing of this is such. This is Uproxx, an article here. We do have a Sydney Sweeney update today. For anybody who wants to know what the latest is, she apparently is the front runner at now the odds on favorites with the betting pool for the next Bond girl. And I guess James Bond counts as Spy-Fi, so we can cover this. Sydney Sweeney is considered the odds on Spy-Fi is an actual thing, by the way.
I am sure
it
of that.
Is. It
I'm
is
sure.
An actual thing.
And now I'm sitting there thinking to Argyle.
Exactly. Yes. Spy-Fi is a
down
thing.
To the bad clothing and the haircut.
So apparently, this is a thing. This is Sydney Sweeney is the it girl of the moment. You remember we talked about everybody is the flavor of the month for a while. Could she also be a Bond girl? The Anyone But You and Euphoria actress is the odds-on favorite to get a ridiculous name like Kissy Suzuki, Pussy Galore, or Harley Goodhead in the next James Bond movie. Instant Casinos has Sydney Sweeney at 5-2. Followed by Jenna Ortega at 11-2, Lily Collins 13-2, Millie Bobby Brown 13-2, and Zoe Deutsch 8-1, who makes more sense than 11 for Stranger Things. I mean,
Did
Millie
you
Bobby
just
Brown's
say
a little
Lily
young.
Collins?
Lily Collins.
Wow.
What?
Oh,
I can see Lily Collins doing it. She was Deja Thoris and John Carter. She was the Princess of Mars, Lily Collins was. She was also Wolverine's girlfriend in the Wolverine origin movie.
Okay, you know, I never saw those.
And yes, Jenna Ortega is too young. Millie Bobby Brown is too young. I'm not familiar with Zoe Deutsch. Sydney Sweeney
you
might
don't
be
know
able
who
to.
Zoe Deutsch is?
not by name. I might recognize her if I saw a picture of her. But this comes on the heels of the news that apparently it's being reported that Aaron Taylor Johnson is going to be the next James Bond. I don't know. For Moneypenny, who is not a Bond girl, Moneypenny is different. Claire Foy currently has the best odds at 4-1, then Emilia Clarke at 6-1, Lily James 13-2, and Jessica Henwick 9-1. I'm not sure. I don't know about Jessica Henwick. That would not work, I don't think. What?
If I'm thinking of who, it's too old, right?
Who? Jessica Henwick?
Yeah.
No, Jessica Henwick played Colleen Wing in Iron Fist. She's young.
Oh, okay, Aiden. Yeah, I'm thinking of someone else.
Yeah. Are you thinking about Jessica? You're thinking maybe about Jessica Chastain.
Probably.
Maybe, okay. So there it is. We have a possible James Bond and Aaron Taylor Johnson, and the odds on favorite for Bond girl Sydney Sweeney. So there is your Sydney Sweeney update for the day. Maybe I got to make a segment opener for that. Do I need to do that like we do headlines and we do memes and we do kind of thing like they do over there on Culture Show or on Comics Division Show? I don't know. Maybe.
Okay, it's Lynn Collins, not Lily Collins, who was in John Carter.
Oh, okay. All right.
That's what was throwing me off. Because I was like, wait a minute. She wasn't in that.
Okay. All right. That's my one mistake for the day.
I'm sorry, guys.
Excuse me.
Yes.
You need to be a little bit more respectful over there.
Pay me more.
I feed you, woman. I built you a desk. And yes, I will milk that for a while.
Uh-huh.
Yes. Yeah, there we go, Gojira.
Today on Live from the Bunker, Star Trek, Disney, and Bond. But first, the Sweeney Watch.
We need to have a fancy name for it, though.
You know what we ought to do? This is what we should do.
Mm-hmm.
We'll do the Sweeney segment, and we'll let Todd do the Sweeney segment, and it'll be called Sweeney's Todd. Or we can flip it around and call it Todd's Sweeney segment.
Oh, okay, that's just nasty. I like it.
And what we can do is we do like, what is it, Conan O'Brien, who did the mouth insert on the picture.
Yes.
And we'll just give Todd a mouth, and somebody can do the Sweeney report for Todd and play. Now I'm thinking about this. Maybe.
This is what I have to live with, guys. And he says he has no sense of humor.
Yeah, Death Angels was about to suggest Todd Sweeney report, too. Yes, great minds think alike.
Yet fools rarely differ.
Listen, you.
Mm-hmm. I'm lucky I'm cute.
Yeah, you are. Okay, where do we go here? Let me do. Should get Brandon on that Sweeney Watch. Mrs. Boss is salty today. I don't know. I haven't.
Just today.
All right. Let me close that tab. What is this one here? That's Hayden.
I mean, since we were talking about Todd Sweeney's watch, might as well jump into Hayden Christensen.
Do we want to do that one?
I mean, like I said, it's all of one subject.
What? What? How is that? No, what?
Oh, come on.
All right. Well, okay.
Seriously, how can you miss that joke?
Maybe. All right, so here we go. So Hayden Christensen was at Indiana Comic Con over the weekend, and somebody came in to the line for the photo ops, and apparently, allegedly, now we don't have any official reporting on this. This is anecdotal, people who were saying they were there and this is what we saw type of thing. So apparently somebody assaulted Hayden Christensen at Indiana Comic Con. Let me interrupt myself for a second. I see a name in the chat I don't recognize. John Kloppenborg. Has John Kloppenborg been here before?
Not that I can remember.
I don't recall seeing that name before.
Hi, John.
John, confirm. Are you a new person coming into the chat here for us? I would want to confirm that so I don't make a mistake here, and do something I shouldn't ought to do. So,
Do it, do it, do it, do it.
I would do it anyway, because that's a name I don't recognize. Welcome, John. He says he's not new as soon as I hit that button. We're going to have to start making a list. Anyway, all right, so Indiana Comic Con, Hayden Christensen's there for photo ops. And somebody reaches and grabs his lightsaber, euphemistically.
Todd Sweeney.
And apparently, I mean, this is that lightsaber, between his legs lightsaber.
Oh, God.
Grabs his crotch. And apparently, when he asked her to step back and leave, she didn't want to. And ended up, she was removed from the premises. This happened sometime, according to the report here. And again, this is not an official media report. This is just, hey, I was there. This is what I saw. So take this for what it's worth. Sometime between 11 and 1 during a photo op, excuse me, a woman was being inappropriate with him. When asked by Hayden himself to cut it out, she didn't, was escorted out, and screamed harassment as she was hauled away. Hayden was then taken away for a while, and then he came back. He chose to continue through the day, his second part of that, and stayed and did photos and autographs and everything else toward the end of that. Now, the timing of this is such that she must have done this because his photo op was not set to start until something like 3 o'clock. So this must have happened during his cooperative photo ops with Rosario Dawson, because there was a block of time there where you could get your picture taken with the two of them, and that's this. So somebody came in and grabbed him while doing a photo op with him and Rosario Dawson. I'm really surprised that nobody clocked this woman. But you can't do that these days, can you?
Nope, because then she would have been a victim, even though she started it.
Yeah, I know. Green Girl says, sounds like the time I accidentally tripped and fell into David Tennant. Well, you know, or you know, following George R. R. Martin out of the men's room and forgetting to ask him for an interview.
Okay, I didn't sit there and, like, offer to help or anything. I didn't walk in there. I just stood outside the door. I was respectful of his time in there.
Yeah. Yeah. And yeah, that's, I mean, it's not just assault. It's sexual assault. It clearly is. And if there are enough witnesses, and I'm assuming there are, you could press charges, but apparently he has decided not to press charges, according to what I saw this morning. So, nice guy.
The problem, okay, yeah, you're a nice guy, however, you are going to continuously have people who think they can get away with doing this, flying over the judges' table and beating the judge up or anything like that and get away with it, mm-hmm. because that is where we are at. You can't be nice. There's a point where you have to be held accountable. And like I said, she'd end up playing the victim card. But it doesn't matter. You know, embarrass the heck out of them, at least.
Well,
publicly.
There is a report here that does mention her by name. I'm not sharing that.
Not enough.
It's not.
She doesn't deserve to have the attention like that in any way, shape, or form. But it doesn't matter. I mean, you sit there and you have people who think they can get away with it.
Yeah.
So.
It's just one of those things. I'm reporting on this. Now the other person, I sound weird in this headphones. I see Don Ranger Power coming in. He says, speaking of Disney, who besides me is ready for a Wizards of Waverly Place revival? We're getting one. Yeah, it's coming. So another Star Wars star who's getting ready to fight back, I guess you could say. This posted over on Gina Carano's Twixer account. She says, quote, therapy back in full swing. Let the healing begin. It's a photograph of some boxing gloves. And everybody in the thread here, the responses are, you know, you go girl, yes, lay queen, and all of that. And I don't see anybody asking her exactly what she means by this. You know, there's a lot of, you know, votes for encouragement. We got your back. We love you, and that sort of thing. But I see this. And here I am. I'm conditioned now. I've been taught, because I'm a media professional, and I've had conversations with other people that are in the industry. This is tactical. There's a reason for her to have posted this today, I think. The timing of this. My first reaction to this is Gina's getting back in fighting shape. Now, the last couple of podcasts, some people have noticed she's gained some weight. She's not looking too good. She's not looking very healthy. She's even acknowledged that she's out of shape because the Ronda Rousey thing keeps coming up. And she's like, no, I'm nowhere near fighting shape for anything to do anything like that. But that also means that she's not in any shape to do the stunts for anything like The Mandalorian or another Haywire or whatever else that she's got on the books. So if she's starting to train again, this is a sign. This, to me, is a signal that she's sending out to the industry, because we did that whole big article in The Hollywood Reporter. Her rehabilitation from persona non grata to a bankable star has begun. Now, does this mean she's getting back in shape to do stunt work on The Mandalorian? Does it mean she's getting back in fighting shape to go back into the MMA? And take, maybe she does Ronda Rousey's fight. Maybe they decide they're going to do something like that. I don't know. But this is a sign of something. Oh, come on. What is going on here? My email keeps kicking me out.
Yeah, I've been having that issue. It's annoying.
All right, so it's not just me. It's on them.
Yes.
By the way, I did get a notification back from podcasts.com.
And what's
basically telling
today?
Us, it's not us, it's you. Nobody else is having any problem. And I said, well, I wasn't having a problem, and I haven't changed anything. So it's not me. It's you. But, you know, well, we're sorry to see you go. So I don't know what's going to happen with stuff. Okay, let me look at this here real quick. Because we have a couple of updates with regard to Star Wars and Lucasfilm. Now, take this. I know there are people out there that are going to sit there and just say, this is all bogus. I'm going to share what I'm reading here. I share from thatparkplace.com, and I share when Valiant Renegade's got stuff, and I share when Camera Posh's got stuff. And Camera Posh's got something today. he's saying here that Sparrow got in touch with him a few minutes ago. This is a quote. He's quoting Sparrow. John Favreau has prepared a document that outlines every mistake that Bob Iger has made, with evidence showing how John warned against them, up to and including keeping Kathleen Kennedy around for the last 10 years. John has drawn up a list of people he wants gone, and people he wants to let their contract expire. It also has what projects he wants to move forward. Basically saying, these are my demands, is what it looks like. Which, in and of itself, okay, fine, you can just look at this as being a rumor and whatever. But this comes on the heels of this really big article. Where is it? Really big article in the Hollywood Reporter. Bob Iger's Invincible era is over. That's the headline. See, now remember last week I told you all of last week we're getting all these Disney is great headlines, all these Disney is great articles to boost the value of the Walt Disney Company and reassure the shareholders so they vote the white card and they keep the board of directors that they've got and Nelson Peltz gets kicked to the curb. This week, I think we're going to see some balance in the force. This is Alex Weprin reporting in the Hollywood Reporter. If Bob Iger were a Marvel superhero, his power would be persuasion. The Disney CEO has long leaned on his ability to convince others of his plans. From film and TV writers, directors, and stars to Disney shareholders to the company's own board members, Iger's track record has been impeccable. That's arguable. Considered possibly the most important deal he ever led, Disney's $4 billion acquisition of Marvel Entertainment in 2009. Wait a minute. Hold on. That was the most important deal? Not the Star Wars acquisition? Not the Lucasfilm deal? Not the 20th Century Fox deal? But the most important deal that Iger brokered was the Marvel acquisition? Why is that? Could it be because he pulled Marvel away from Ike Perlmutter? I don't know. While Marvel's success since then is not in dispute, at the time, the idea of Disney chasing young men via the comic book brand was seen as a real risk. In his 2019 memoir, The Ride of a Lifetime, Iger recalls how he pitched a skeptical Steve Jobs on the deal. Jobs, who had sold Pixar to Disney just a couple of years earlier, was Disney's largest shareholder and a member of the board. He also told Iger that he had never read a comic book in his life. Quote, so I brought an encyclopedia of Marvel characters with me to explain the universe to him and show him what we would be buying, Iger recalled. Jobs ultimately bought into the idea and called Marvel chairman Ike Perlmutter to vouch for Iger, helping to seal the deal. 15 years later, Disney finds itself at a crossroads facing a bitter proxy fight with Nelson Peltz and his try-in partners, who are backed by billions of dollars in Disney stock owned by Perlmutter, all set to come to a head April 3rd at Disney's annual meeting. Now, let's switch over here to another article from Hollywood Reporter about another advisory firm backing Nelson Peltz. Nelson Peltz is getting some traction here. This is the firm Egan Jones recommending Disney shareholders vote to add Nelson Peltz and Jay Rasulo to the studio's board of directors. So ISS came out a few days ago saying, yeah, you should go ahead and put Nelson Peltz on the board. And now you have Egan Jones saying, yeah, you should put Nelson Peltz and Jay Rasulo on the board. Now, Rasulo has been a CFO at Disney. He knows the numbers. And it's very, very difficult for you to argue that he's not qualified to sit on the board of directors for a company where he was the chief financial officer for many, many, many years. And prior to that was running the parks. He knows the business. He's familiar with it because he was there. The firm also backed Peltz's try-in partners in recommending shareholders withhold their votes for current Disney board members Michael Froman and Maria Elena Lagomasino. That follows Institutional Shareholder Services coming out as the first advisory firm to back Peltz in his proxy fight ahead of Disney shareholders casting votes to the company's annual meeting on April 3rd, which is a week from today. Now, back to this other article here. We're going to go back through here. Iger has been pulling out all the stops to convince Disney shareholders. Given its long history and high profile, Disney has a higher percentage of retail shareholders than most companies, that the company is in the middle of a turnaround and that Peltz is a distraction that will ultimately hurt the company rather than help it. Quote, this campaign is, in a way, designed to distract us to take our eye off those balls, Iger said at a Morgan Stanley conference March 5th. And that goes back to that three-minute ad campaign video that they did, hit piece on Peltz and Rizzullo for a couple of weeks ago. I mean, Disney's running scared on this stuff. They really, really, they're pulling out all the stops to try to make sure that Peltz and Rizzullo don't get on the board. Iger and the Disney board have lined up a murderer's row of public supporters. Interesting choice of metaphors there. Securing letters of support from not only Lorraine Powell Jobs, Steve Jobs' widow, former Disney CEO Michael Eisner, and J.P. Morgan CEO Jamie Dimon, who's on the board of directors of J.P. Morgan Chase with Melody, with George Lucas's wife. Star Wars, but also Star Wars filmmaker George Lucas, who disagrees with Iger about the right approach for future films in the sci-fi universe, incidentally. So that even reinforces, yo, look, George doesn't like what Iger's doing with Star Wars, but even he says that Iger should do it. Doesn't that kind of undermine the effectiveness, the impact of Lucas endorsing Iger? Because you're saying here in this article, yeah, George Lucas even came out in support of Iger, but he doesn't like what they've been doing with his baby. That's kind of contradictory, don't you think? On purpose? By accident? Remember, these trade articles are not accidents, nor are they coincidental in their timing. These things don't just happen in a vacuum. And Disney secured letters of support from the families of Walt Disney and Roy Disney, including Abigail Disney, who has long critiqued Iger over his pay packages and the company's treatment of its employees. Well, Abigail Disney is a communist anyway. Just saying. So now there are now two companies that have come out in support of Nelson Peltz. And as Cam points out in the chat, we also have a settlement in the Florida case. I gotta read this. I think this is the Reedy Creek lawsuit. Disney and the state of Florida have settled a legal battle. This is Hollywood Reporter. Settled a legal battle for control of the district that oversees development around the company's theme parks. So this is the Reedy Creek lawsuit. And I imagine Legal Mindset would probably have a video on this, so you got to check that out. The deal resolves litigation in state court accusing the entertainment giant of covertly cobbling together a series of 11th-hour deals to illicitly retain the powers that allowed it to oversee development around its sprawling theme park. So basically, the lawsuit was saying, we came up with this new district that's not Reedy Creek. And Disney was coming up with all sorts of different shenanigans in order to try to maintain the Reedy Creek District and also their control of the Reedy Creek District instead of this new one that the state of Florida put together as part of new legislation from last year, year before last. So, okay. So there's a settlement in this lawsuit right before the shareholders meeting. That's not coincidental timing either. There is no coincidence on any of this stuff, folks. We also have this. Hulu is now active and live on Disney Plus. The bundle officially has launched. It's been in beta, but it's now available. And hey, looky here. Here's all the stuff. Company says viewing during three-month beta exceeded its expectations. So here's another Disney is Great article that the trades are going to do. So Hulu is now on Disney Plus, available in a bundle. I think it costs an extra $2 or something. So let's see where. Let's see where Disney is sitting now on their stock price, shall we? Let's take a look. The Walt Disney Company. Oh. Interesting. So over the past 5 days, it has gone up and is now going down. It's sitting at $120 a share and some change. $120.16. This is today. It peaked. Let's see where it spiked. It spiked at $121.89 this morning, and it has steadily declined. I guess you could see it at some of these points where some of the articles dropped today, but it has been a steady decline over the day, and it is down $120.15. That's up 0.22% today from yesterday, the previous close of $119.93. So the Walt Disney Company, I mean, if you're gonna get some shares, I guess you could have it, wait until the stock price goes down a little bit more. I am not giving you financial advice whatsoever. I don't know if this is a sign that we're winning. I don't know if this is a sign that Iger is about to give up. But you have these articles now that are basically saying, you know, there's a shift in these things. And it's no accident when these articles drop. The timing of these things, the schedule, these are all deliberate pieces of, not necessarily propaganda, but this is all marketing. This is all marketing and PR. And there's a strategy to this. It's like, okay, well, we did this, and we didn't get the results we want, so now we're going to do this. And that gets us a little bit further down, and now we do this, and that gets us a little bit further, and now we do this, and that gets us a little bit further. And it's a kick the can type of thing. But for a marketing strategy, you plan this stuff out. And you say, okay, well, we're going to have this story here, this story here. This is going to publish it in Hollywood Reporter. This one's going to go to Variety. This one's a Deadline. We'll give this interview here. We'll do this press release here. We'll post this social media stuff. And it's all coordinated. And the trades are in on it. I mean, there's no question about that. But the studios use the trades. Deadline, Hollywood Reporter, Variety are the top three. There are others out there, but those are the top three. And those are the ones that are basically the mouthpieces of the studio. So if you're going to do any kind of an interview, any kind of press release, any kind of a major big announcement, or if you're going to start dropping signals to the industry that something is about to happen, or something's about to change, or you're about to take a position on something, this is how you do it. You start throwing these preliminary articles out, like we got last Friday with Variety giving us an article about Paramount being sold in piecemeal, and we're going to talk about that here after the break. But now you have this massive article about Bob Iger and his time he's no longer invincible. Now we have these articles saying, you know what, maybe Nelson Peltz does need to be on the board. And Bob Iger is not invincible. And Peltz, that whole thing, the shift in the message there has been focused on succession. So, you know, we had that article drop on, I think it was on Sunday, where he was saying, no, Bob Iger is not a target on this. We're targeting members of the board. We want to change the makeup of the board in order to have, you know, new strategy in the way we do business. Well, Bob's position as CEO is going to be impacted by that. Stone Martin Weasel attack, where? Are we buffering? Uh-oh. I haven't seen it. Okay. I'll keep an eye out. I have not gotten any indication that we've got a signal loss, so we should be okay. Maybe. But this kind of thing is what they use when they're, and this article here says, well, maybe Bob's not the guy. Because if they botched the succession, because Peltz is talking about they botched the succession from Iger to Chapek, and they didn't properly vet Chapek. I mean, that's the prevailing story. That's the narrative, is that they didn't vet Bob Chapek properly. They didn't give him time to develop any kind of a relationship with the board of directors prior to being named CEO. He was just dropped in their laps. I don't believe they had that situation, but that's how they're presenting it now. All right, so no issues today on Mazur's end, and John doesn't have any buffering either. Okay, so hopefully we're okay. But this sends a signal out. This is, well, you know, we're talking to succession because, you know, Bob's supposed to be there only 2 years. And one of the big problems with Chapek's run is that Bob Iger never left. And so you've got this shadow looming over Bob Chapek as CEO because Bob Iger never went away. Well, that's a succession problem in and of itself. You give the job to a new guy, and then you don't let him do the job without sitting there and seeming to question everything. That's a problem. So the next succession from Bob Iger to whoever becomes the next CEO, it has to be a clean break. It has to be, okay, Bob, you're done. You can still be on the board of directors or whatever if they vote to have you on. But as CEO, you're done, which means you get out of the office and you get off the campus of the Walt Disney Company. You're retired. Bye. Don't let the door hit you on the way out. Now, whether he retires or they fire him, that'll be a decision about what are the best optics at the time. We've decided to part ways. Difference of creative opinion. Whatever else. They'll never admit to firing Bob Iger. I don't think they'll fire him. I think it will be, I retired once. I came back to fix things. Everything's in good hands. Now I'm going to go away again. He will ride off into the sunset. Hail the conquering hero and whatever. But we're starting to see these little... Excuse me. We're starting to see these little indicators that there is a shift in the narrative. And if this thing about Jon Favreau making a bunch of lists about, you know, the mistakes that Iger made, that information coming out at the same time Hollywood Reporter does this big write-up on, you know, maybe Bob Iger isn't as secure in his job as we all thought, that's a shift in the narrative. Because up until this point, Bob Iger was unassailable. We didn't hear anything about Iger being vulnerable. And now we are. So, I'm just saying, take that with a grain of salt. It doesn't necessarily mean anything. This post here from Gina may not necessarily mean anything. I mean, it's very easy to make assumptions and to start reading into things, but it doesn't necessarily mean what we might think it means. Meanwhile, over on the Marvel front, we've got Anthony Mackie talking about Twisted Metal, because his, you know, Twisted Metal is out now on streaming, and they're talking about the difference between that and his job at Marvel. Now, remember, they're reshooting pretty much all of Captain Marvel in the World Economic Forum. But this article here, there's one little piece that I wanna highlight, because he's talking about, you know, growing up as a gamer, you know, the games he used to play when he was a kid, and the work that he's doing on Twisted Metal, which is a new TV series. It's on Paramount Plus, and it's based on the video game. And they ask him about this production compared to his time on Marvel stuff. And he says one interesting thing. Quote, I would say the Marvel thing is completely different just because it's such a space of controlled entertainment. Like, there's only so much you can do. There's only so much creativity you can bring to the table because Stan Lee gave us so much content. Now, the rest of what he's talking about here is, you know, you're working within the confines of the source material. Sam Wilson is only so much of a type of a character because the comic book said this is Sam Wilson. Whereas in Twisted Metal, there's no story so much. You don't have these characters. You're basically creating out of whole cloth a backstory and a history and dimension to these characters and whatnot. You get a little bit more freedom of movement creatively. But controlled entertainment. What does Nia DaCosta say when she was directing the Marvels? This is Kevin Feige's thing. And Nelson Peltz and Tryon Partners have questioned whether Kevin Feige still has the juice to keep going on the Marvel Cinematic Universe because of mistakes that have been made in Phase 4 and 5. It's all connected. It's all connected, folks. I would say that the industry is starting to recognize and acknowledge to a certain extent Bob Iger's vulnerability. And I think now that you've got two different consulting firms that are sitting there saying, yeah, you know, maybe Nelson Peltz does need to be on the board. I think this week we'll start to see more of that. I think this week we'll start to see some articles that balance out all of the hype and the propaganda stuff we got last week. Disney's great. Give us chocolate cake. And this week we're going to get a little bit more dose of reality and say, well, maybe not so much. Maybe it's not quite as good as we make it out to be. Cam, Bob Iger doesn't currently work for the Disney company. We have no plans for him to work here in the future. I'd go for that. John says, go WWE on that. We wish Bob Iger the best in his future endeavors. Yeah, and look, I have no personal animosity toward Bob Iger or Kathleen Kennedy or Kevin Feige or Ike Perlmutter or any of these guys. I don't care. I don't know them. I'm not a shareholder. If I was a shareholder in the Walt Disney Company, I would be all over this stuff deep, and I would be making phone calls, and I would be asking questions, and I would be sending emails and say, okay, what is the plan? What is your plan for recovery? What is your plan for course correction? Is the Walt Disney Company going to survive in its current state, or is it going to collapse like a bridge in Baltimore? Because Bob Iger is the wrong guy to be in charge. And the board of directors needs to make that decision, or Iger needs to come to that conclusion himself and say, you know what? We're past my time. And that's what needs to happen. There needs to be an acknowledgement, and I think we're starting to get it. I think this big article is the beginning of that, that Bob Iger's time is over. Now, when we get back, I'm going to take a real quick break. When we get back, we've got some Star Trek news. We have some Warner Brothers. We do have Warner Brothers news. We have some Star Trek news. We have some Paramount news. That's coming right after this. Don't go anywhere.
Live from the bunker. We'll be right back on Sci-Fi for Me TV.
And it's a real pleasure for me as a longtime fan to be sitting here with Aaron Grey. Ray.
Here with Larry Hama.
We're talking with Kevin J. Anderson, best-selling author.
Mr. Neil Adams.
I am here with David Prince.
Axel Alonso, editor.
Shadow Stevens.
And Devil's Comic-Con with John Delancey.
With Tom King.
Kevin Conroy.
Free comic book
Denise Crosby.
PopCon Pop Expo.
Here on location at Star Wars Celebration.
First FA Expo, talking for our second time with Gil Gerard.
Wichita, Kansas at Time Eddie.
Producer David Gerald.
Yeah, I've got Eric Flint.
We are here at Smallville Comic-Con.
Wizard World St. Louis.
Village Con in Bentonville, Arkansas.
With Michael Lombardi.
We were talking with Alan Dean.
Quincy Allen.
Suzanne Landon.
Founder of Starlog Magazine. Mr. Kerry Oakwood.
Chris Sami.
Lynn Lee.
Dave Schwartz.
Mano Interrami.
Johnny.
Jason Aaron.
This is Sci-Fi for Me, your portal to the science fiction multiverse. Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Be sure to connect with us on social media and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss our next broadcast. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
I can't even hear myself now. Did you guys hear me? All right, welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. I have no idea what's going on in my headphones. I can barely hear myself. I don't know. Can you guys hear me okay? Can y'all hear me all right? You can? Okay. This is very strange. I did some adjustments here, and I don't know why I'm suddenly not able to hear myself very well. So anyway, okay, so let us do this. Big story in Variety about Star Trek. This is not that story. Let's start with this. Star Trek 4 beams up new screenwriter. The flight attendant co-creator Steve Yockey. This is exclusive to Variety. It's reported today. Let us look at this. I'm gonna get face cancer with all these monitors. No, I'll be fine. Steve Yockey. Who is this? In this reporting on this, Adam Very reporting in Variety. Steve Yockey, co-creator of the Max series, The Flight Attendant, is joining Starfleet as the new screenwriter for Star Trek IV, which is technically Star Trek 14 if you want to count all of the ones that are actually really Star Trek movies. Story details remain under a powerful cloaking device. Writer trying to be clever. But Paramount Pictures still intends the project to be the final chapter for the cast that rebooted the franchise in movie theaters with 2009 Star Trek, including Chris Pine, Zachary Quinto, bringing the cast back following 2016 Star Trek Beyond has proven trickier for the studio than finding an altruistic Ferengi. Oh, come on. Just write the article. At least three previous attempts fell apart for various reasons, most recently with director Max Shackman and screenwriters Lindsay Beer and Geneva Robertson-Duaret at the studio had slated open 2013. Yaki's involvement is the most promising sign of forward momentum the project has had since. The playwright started his TV writing career on the MTV series Awkward and Scream before joining the writing staff of Supernatural for four seasons. All right, so he's got a little bit of geek cred. Okay, fine. His latest series, the Sandman Universe adaptation Dead Boy Detectives, will premiere on Netflix in April. Paramount is also developing a separate Star Trek project with writer Seth Graham Smith and directed by Toby Haynes that would feature a new cast in a story meant as a kind of origin story for the franchise. A project with screenwriter Kalinda Vasquez, first announced in 2021, also remains in development. Now, they mentioned those two projects just to say, hey, there's still some Star Trek stuff going on. Really? There is. It is. Really? Because look at this massive article here in Variety that dropped today. That's a heck of a piece of artwork, I tell you. It really is. This is impressive. But what gets me more than anything else is the particular choice that they've done for Kirk. The most prominent image of Kirk here is him yelling at Khan. Khan! So we have angry William Shatner, because they don't, various reasons, for whatever reason, I don't know, they don't like doing it. Now, Shatner as Kirk is in here in a number of different places. Him, you know, sitting at the chair, and him covered in tribbles. And okay, we see, at least he's in the montage. At least he's there. The collage, not montage, the collage. But look at how Leonard Nimoy is featured as Spock. I mean, Nimoy looks pretty good here, right? So here is the article, The Future of Star Trek, by Adam Vary. He must be their go-to guy. From Starfleet Academy to new movies and Michelle Yeoh, how the 58-year-old franchise is planning for the next generation of fans. This dropped at 8 a.m. Pacific today. Okay, so it starts with an interview with Anson Mount talking about playing the captain of the Enterprise and all of these. I'm not going to go through all of it because I want you to look here. This is a very, very, very long article. But there are some key points. Because Alex Kurtzman is part of this article. And they start with Strange New Worlds. In the 58 years since, the Star Trek galaxy has logged 900 television episodes and 13 feature films, amounting to 668 hours, nearly 28 days of content to date. I hate that word, content. Even compared with Star Wars and the Marvel Cinematic Universe, Star Trek stands as the only storytelling venture to deliver a single narrative experience for this long across TV and film. Now, it could be argued, Adam, this is not a single narrative experience. There are three. You have original Star Trek, OG Star Trek, Classic Trek, which is six TV series and 10 movies. Star Trek, Star Trek the Animated Series, Star Trek the Next Generation, Star Trek Deep Space Nine, Star Trek Voyager, Enterprise. Six shows. And then 10 movies. That's OG Classic Trek. And then you have another narrative experience with Kelvin Trek. And then you have another narrative experience with Kurtzman Trek. These are not the same. These are not the same. Does that sound a little bit better? I think that sounds a little better to me right there. All right. So you don't have one single narrative experience. You have three. If you want a single narrative experience over that much time, you look at Doctor Who. All right. To keep Star Trek thriving has meant charting a precarious course to satisfy the fans who have fueled it for decades while also discovering innovative ways to get new audiences on board. You don't necessarily need a new audience. You just need to expand the one you got with the same kind of people. Well, you got to try to keep the one you got. Yes. Kurtzman says, doing Star Trek means you have to deliver something that's entirely familiar and entirely fresh at the same time. Fulfilling that mandate has never been more vital to Paramount Global, which needs the franchise to flourish while the company competes in a troubled streaming economy and burnishes its value for potential buyers. There's the nugget right there of this whole article. That one piece right there, burnish its value for potential buyers. That's what this entire article is about. Look how important and valuable and great Star Trek is. This is a sales pitch for the IP. That's my take. All of the rest of this is fluff. All of the rest of this is fluff. David Staff, president of CBS Studios, he says, we take it very seriously. Star Trek is one of the most valued, treasured, and to-be-nurtured franchises in all of media. The franchise has certainly weathered its share of fallow periods, most recently after Nemesis bombed in theaters in 2002 and UPN canceled Enterprise in 2005. It took 12 years for Star Trek to return to television with the premiere of Discovery in 2017. Since then, however, there has been more Star Trek on TV than ever. The adventure series Strange New Worlds, the animated comedy Lower Decks. Well, at least he got the title right. And the kids series Prodigy are all in various stages of production. And the serialized thriller Picard concluded last year when it ranked, along with Strange New Worlds, among Nielsen's 10 most watched streaming original series for multiple weeks. Nearly 1 in 5 Paramount Plus subscribers in the U.S. is watching at least one Star Trek series, according to the company. And more than 50% of fans watching one of the new Trek shows also watch at least two others. The new shows air in 200 international markets and are dubbed into 35 languages. As Discovery launches its 5th and final season in April, Star Trek is in many ways stronger than it's ever been. Yeah, this is exactly it, Weatherman. Buy my Buick. She's still got a lot of good miles on her. New tires, new transmission. I want to go through here, down here. You've got the fact that, you know, things are aging. But here is something from Kurtzman, because there have been reports, and I have told you about this, what I have been told, that Alex Kurtzman wants out. That's what I have been told, is Alex Kurtzman wants out. This is the key. They are trying to make Star Trek really, really, really attractive. The problem is that the licensing and the legal entanglements for this particular IP mean that it's going to be that much more difficult for a sale to happen, because people want these IPs unencumbered. And they're a mess from what I hear. So here we go here. Production designer Jonathan Lee toured the Enterprise. This goes back to the whole 25% difference. Kelvin Trek has a license and you got 25% difference. Kurtzman Trek has a license and it's 25% different. They own their piece of each license and they are different from the OG classic Trek license. And all of it being there's TV, there's movies, you've got the comic. Who owns what? Now, it's not as bad as the Buckaroo Banzai rights question because nobody knows who owns any of that. Because the guy who had it killed himself and didn't keep records of who he sold what to. So nobody knows who owns rights on anything. We'll never see Buckaroo Banzai again. But I want to go through here because, you know, you're talking, yeah, they're going through and this is all great and wonderful and everything. But I want to go down here because we got Michelle Yeoh doing her Section 31 thing, which is completely unnecessary. Michelle Yeoh is on board for a sequel. If anybody wants to do a sequel, okay, fine. But this is where I want to go into the studio. This is Adam Vary writing. I lost count of the number of times someone made a point to me with real pride how one or the other of the Star Trek TV productions is saving money, whether it be Section 31 repurposing sets from Discovery or Strange New Worlds redressing the same set to be everything from crew quarters to sparring gym. No one will get specific about budgets, but Kurtzman says that Section 31 costs so much less than you'd ever make a Star Trek movie for. That's because Kurtzman is putting up at least half of the budget out of his own pocket. Kurtzman is partially financing Section 31 himself. So yes, it is cheaper for CBS Studios to make it because they're not paying for all of it. A question from Azers, is there a contractual obligation for Star Trek IV? I'm not aware of one. I know they have announced it and they've been talking about it and this thing has been the thing that they've been wanting to do for a while. I don't know if there is a legal obligation to still be fulfilled between Paramount, CBS, and Bad Robot. There might be. Maybe. I don't know, but if the Star Trek IP gets sold and the Warner Brothers offer is dead because of how complicated all of this is with regard to the rights. So who knows who's going to buy Star Trek? But this is the sales pitch for Star Trek. Look at how great it is. But in Kurtzman's case, he's talking about, and I got to find it here, and they talk about the toxic fandom and Starfleet Academy. Starfleet Academy is never going to happen. Starfleet Academy is never going to happen. They're in the writer's room. They've got Star Trek writers and they got fans and whatever. But at the end, it says here, and this is the takeaway for me. After they break for lunch, they're talking about the Starfleet Academy writer's room, which, okay, you go. Kurtzman is asked how much longer he plans to keep making Star Trek. This is a quote now. The minute I fall out of love with it is the minute that it's not for me anymore. I'm not there yet, he says. To be able to build in this universe to tell stories that are fundamentally about optimism and a better future at a time when the world seems to be falling apart, it's a really powerful place to live every day. Now, here's my question for you, Alex. Does this optimism and a better future involve crying at the drop of a hat? Because that seems to be your go-to take for Michael Burnham. That's just me. Now, this runs counter to what I've been told from the inside, where Kurtzman wants out. Kurtzman wants his ownership to be bought out. He wants Secret Hideout to be done. He wants the ties to be severed. So, we have two competing stories with regard to Alex Kurtzman and Star Trek. We have two competing stories with regard to Star Trek in general. The IP is a mess in terms of the legal entanglements, the ownership, the rights, and all that other stuff, which is complicating the sale of Paramount Global. Because Star Trek is a crown jewel of sorts for CBS and Paramount. It has been since they bought the Desilu Studios all those many, many, many moons ago. And whether it's Gulf and Western or Viacom or whoever else, CBS and Paramount have been, you know, Star Trek has been a moneymaker. It can be when it's done right. Nemesis didn't fail because people were tired of seeing Star Trek. Nemesis failed because it told a bad story. I mean, Nemesis did not fail because people are tired of Star Trek. Star Trek V failed because it wasn't executed well. Nemesis, same thing. It was poor execution of a bad idea. But this is a very, 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 very long article to basically say Star Trek is great. Please buy it. Please. Please. But Star Trek is also, yes, it might be the crown jewel, but it's also one of the stumbling blocks, apparently, for people who are looking at this thing going, yeah, maybe we could buy Paramount. Oh, no. Maybe not so much. So it'll be interesting to see how this goes, because if they can figure out what to do with Star Trek, if somebody can come in and say, oh, you know what? I'm just going to buy this whole thing. Buying all of the different pieces and parts is not enough to disentangle it, I'm told, because of how all of this stuff kind of plays out. So I don't know. We'll see. It's an ongoing thing. But again, coordinated campaign. Nothing happens in a vacuum. These articles drop at a certain particular time as part of a strategy. Now, the strategy over at the Disney stuff is we have to shore up Bob Iger. We have to shore up the current board of directors, but maybe not so much because now, you know, the trades are starting to read the writing on the wall and you're starting to get a little bit of pushback and say, you know, the industry thinks that maybe Bob Iger is done. There is a narrative to this. There's a narrative to all of the flow of the articles as they come out. Look at what kind of story is being told with each one. Now, with Star Trek, with Paramount, the same thing. Last week, we had the trial balloon. Maybe Paramount is worth more if they sell it off in pieces. Look, here's the shiny big piece called Star Trek. Please buy it. Please, please, please buy this product. But wait, there's more. You know, this is the, you know, it slices, it dices, it makes Julian Fry's article. Who knows what happens? Maybe it's time to just put Star Trek to bed. And they're not going to do that, of course, because it does make, you know, if it's done right, like I said, if it's done right, it can make money. So somebody is going to end up with Star Trek. It won't be Kurtzman. Kurtzman's done with it. Abrams is done. Now, whether they do Star Trek 4 or not, I don't think they're ever going to do Star Trek 4. Star Trek 14. Kelvin Trek 4. Whatever you want to call it. I don't think it's ever going to happen. They'll go through the motions. They'll spend the money on the script. Or they'll do whatever. And then they'll decide, to, you know, this is not working out. Oh, hey, it sold. It's not our problem anymore. See ya, wouldn't want to be ya. Meanwhile, we've got other franchise news, other things to report. Godzilla X-Con expecting $135 million global opening. Here we go. We've got Easter box office preview here. Godzilla and King Kong on Easter weekend. Anyway. This is the strategy. Stateside 5-day launch for Godzilla versus Kong over Easter weekend. They're hoping to do the same thing here. So they're predicting $135 million global opening weekend for that. We've got Dune 2 getting criticized because they don't have enough Middle Eastern and North African actors involved on a planet 10,000 years in the future where ethnicities have probably all blended together by then. Who knows? I don't know. Three Body Problem sneaks into number 2 on Netflix TV charts after streaming debut. So this was yesterday in Deadline. The series invaded the streamer's top 10, second place for the week of March 18th to 24th. Launching on March 21st, Three Body Problem managed 11 million views in its first 4 days. And according to Netflix, Three Body Problem reached the top 10 in 93 countries. By the way, X-Men 97, 4 million views, I think is what I saw for the first couple of episodes. So it's doing all right. But 11 million in 4 days, that's, I guess, okay. But I mean, it's enough for number 2 in the list, in the top 10 list. So there's that. And we're going to get a Bad Guys 2. Did anybody see the Bad Guys, the first one from DreamWorks? Did anybody see this movie? It's getting a sequel. Yeah, Eclay says, I'm surprised that many people watch the Three Body Problem. It's kind of highbrow. Well, it kind of is, you know, and then you've got the books. You've got a Chinese production that a lot of people have seen. But the American production is getting a lot of buzz, a lot of positive buzz. That 70s rock fan, Brian, has said it's pretty good. They've been talking about it over on Comics Division's channel. Excuse me. And it's better than lousy, I guess. Gojira said she saw it. Not great, but it had its moments. Story of my life. Not great, but it has its moments. But anyway, yeah, we're getting a Bad Guys 2 late summer 2025. Universal Pictures and DreamWorks Animation. The Bad Guys grossed $250 million? Really? Okay. Follows the crackerjack criminal crew of animal outlaws who are struggling to find trust and acceptance in their newly minted lives as good guys. However, they're pulled out of retirement and forced to do one last job by an all-female squad of criminals. Oh, boy. Okay. Part 2 will reteam the first picks, filmmakers, and cast. The movie is based on Aaron Blabby's New York Times best-selling book series. Okay. Well, maybe this part 2 with the all-women crew is old enough to not be part of the message. Oscar winner Sam Rockwell back as dashing reformed pickpocket Mr. Wolf. Mark Maron plays safecracker Mr. Snake. Craig Robinson is master of disguise Mr. Shark. Mr. Clark is over on the Tom Clancy stuff. Okay, so we got a sequel to The Bad Guys coming from from Universal, Comcast Universal. So there we go. All right, so that's the thing. That's it for today. E. Clay Thomas, I've never heard of The Bad Guys. Gajir said, I think Zootopia did it better, but this had a fun caper vibe. I guess at some point I'll probably have to go watch it. I don't know. I looked at it and went, okay, that could be fun, and then I never watched it, so I have so many things on my to-do list, on my catch-up list, on my stuff to do. It's not even funny. So, anyway, that's it for today, folks. This is what we got. I'm going to go ahead and call a lid on it. We're not going to do call-in today. Open Line Friday Open Line Friday this week is going to be an indie creator showcase. So pass the word. I'm going to post it out on social media later on today. We're going to do indie creator showcase on Friday. So if you know people who are making comic books or games or writing novels or RPGs or video games or whatever, music, indie creator showcase in the science fiction, fantasy, horror space, let's bring them out, trot them out, and put on a show on Friday. In the meantime, connect with us on all the different socials. And we've got the video channels there, the newsletter. Mrs. Boss had mentioned the newsletter earlier. We've got a Discord channel. You can connect with us there. And if you're in the Discord, you can actually, like, participate in the conversation over on the Discord. We've got a subscribers to our account if you want to support us that way. So that's it for us today, folks. Thanks very much for being here. I do appreciate all of you who are here, whether you're here for the very first time, you're here as a repeat guest. I appreciate every one of you who gives me some of your time and attention every day whenever you're here. So let's keep that up, and let's see if maybe we can get our subscriber count up to 2515 by tomorrow. Maybe. So, all right, that's it for us today, folks. Thanks very much for being here. Remember, the politicians hate you, the media lies to you, but God has a plan for you, and there are four lights.
This has been a presentation of Sci-Fi for Me TV. Copyright 2024 by Flaming Dog Media, LLC. All rights reserved. No portion of this program may be retransmitted without the express written consent of Flaming Dog Media. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV.